George Mariner Mall here for the Discovery Orchestra. In this Discovery Orchestra chat, we're continuing our exploration of the fourth movement of Dvorak's Ninth Symphony, From the New World. We're about to investigate the development section of this movement. And just to remind you, it is in the development section of sonata form movements that composers take some of the musical ideas they presented in the exposition and change them, manipulate them, turn them upside down. Develop them with one aim in mind, to have us notice these changes and feel the emotional ramifications of those changes. Look at number 13 in the listening guide. We have a question-answer event happening. There are two pairs of questions played by the flutes and answered by the French horns. Your mission? Which musical themes are used here? Here's the music. So, the question, is based on the Three Blind Mice idea. I knew you could identify it. And the answer, played by the French horns, is good old theme one. But notice how Dvorak has developed it or changed it. In the exposition, this theme is very serious, almost ominous. But now he's defanged it. Listen. He's giving it to us in a major key. Listen to the orchestra again. Now look at number 14, where there are four pairs of questions and answers. Again, figure out which themes are used. The question is theme one, and the answer is the transition theme. But also notice how Dvorak has changed the character of both of these. Theme one is now in a diminution version of itself in a major key. Diminution is the musical term we use to describe a shrinking process. If the original version, the first version the composer gives us, takes this long, the shrunken or diminution version might sound like this. Frankly, it's almost as though Dvorak is poking fun at himself. You're taking yourself too seriously, Dvorak. Listen to the orchestra again at number 14. At number 15, the violas set up a pattern based on theme one, again in diminution. See the first question mark? The woodwinds come in with theme one from movement two. There are two other question marks. Let me play the music that occurs there. Where does that come from? We've spoken about Dvorak's recycling of themes presented in previous movements. This is a humorous, abbreviated quote of the Section A theme from Movement 3. It's like this theme is saying, "Remember me?" So at number 15, this entire event occurs. Listen to the orchestra. Count how many times it happens. And the answer is 3. And did you notice that each repetition was higher? This whole idea is treated as a 3-step ascending sequence. At number 16, the listening guide says, "Diminution abounds." Let's see what that's about. Listen to the orchestra. Our Movement 2 Theme 1 has just been shrunken, and it's repeated over and over again. Now at number 16, we also see question marks at the end of those 2 crescendo indications. Tell me what's played in those places and by which instruments. Yes, it's the trumpets and trombones playing Movement 2's first theme in the original tempo, once in major, and then in minor. Listen again. At number 17, we find that theme 1 of the 4th movement now occurs down in the bass range of the orchestral sound. Count how many times it occurs at number 17. And the answer is 3. And did you notice that it's another 3-step ascending sequence? Listen to the orchestra again. At number 18 in the listening guide, you see the word re-transition. This is a designation scholars give to that part of the development in which composers start moving toward the recapitulation, the 3rd major part of the recipe. Sometimes composers wind down the tension level, but, as I hope you can tell, Dvorak is just getting started with tension building. Fill in the blanks at number 18. The question is a shortened version of theme 1 from movement 1. Here's the original followed by this new version. Now to the answer. It was a diminution version of theme 1 from movement 4. At number 19, we have another powerful crescendo, followed by a return of movement 4, theme 1 in all its glory. Have a listen. We've used the word scream several times in these listening guides. It's just the only word I can come up with to describe a moment when the music seems so intense to me. Just what are the violins screaming above the trumpets and horns? They're just playing a descending scale, but it's so high in the violin register and played against theme 1 in the trumpets and horns. Playing this on the piano just doesn't do it justice. Listen again and focus on the 30 violins, especially the first violins playing up in the stratosphere. Now, you may feel like we've just recapitulated, that the orchestra has played music that sounds just like the beginning of this movement. And to refresh your memory, here is the music that Dvorak wrote right after the introduction. But here again is where we just arrived. There are actually many differences, but one of the most important is that it's not in the same key. We just played music in the key of G minor. But in order to officially arrive at the recapitulation, we have to be back in E minor. So, this moment near the end of the development is kind of a false recapitulation. Other composers have done things like this. Beethoven does it in his famous Fifth Symphony near the end of the development of the first movement. But whatever composers do, it's always for a reason, for a purpose. In this case, Dvorak wants to keep turning up the tension. Listen to the music from number 19 to number 21, where we finally do recapitulate in the key of E minor. Do you perhaps remember when I began the previous chat, I said that Dvorak has used sonata form in the creation of the last movement of his Ninth Symphony, but not without some surprises. We've just encountered two of those surprises. One, the false recapitulation, and the other, the recapitulation itself. Although it's in the right key, E minor, it does not really sound exactly like it did at the beginning of the exposition. Let's compare them. Here is theme 1 in the exposition. Now, here's theme 1 in the recapitulation. What are some of the differences or surprises? In the exposition, French horns and trumpets played theme one. In the recapitulation, it's only the trombones, a very different timbre. He also changes the way theme one works. In the exposition, but in the recapitulation, Dvorak gives us the same abbreviated version he gave to us in the false recapitulation. That's it. And the accompaniment from the tutti, all the rest of the orchestra, has also changed. In the exposition, the rhythm of the accompanying chords is this. Chord, 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 chord. But in the recapitulation, Dvorak has the tutti make sustained noise for two measures, followed by unpredictable accented chords. We'll explore more of the changes Dvorak made in the recapitulation in our next chat, but now let's listen to the entire development from number 13 in the listening guide through the beginning of the recapitulation at number 21. Dvorak skillfully takes us from a lighthearted, making fun of himself environment to the intensely serious moment of recapitulation. It's almost as if he were saying, I was just joking, kidding earlier. This is very important, personal information I'm sharing with you. Once again, we're listening to the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Marin Alsop, courtesy of Naxos of America, Incorporated.